Okay, good evening. As you, we can have a series in the Iran series. Welcome to Laplace School of Health Sciences, Department of Clinical Medicine. This is for Clinical Officer General Program, July 2020 intake. And we are looking at clinical applications in medical physiology one, which is PGY 110. And today I'm only going to share you on a series on clinical situation one. Okay? So we are going to look at changes in body fluids, in volume and osmolarity in different clinical situations. This is Emil Lubundi. Okay, a holder of a diploma, Bachelor of Science in Clinical Medicine. Postgraduate certificate in medical education, post basic diploma in public health, postgraduate certificate in health professions education, who is an accredited member, as well as an executive of vice public secretary for Zambia Medicalization Practitioner Association. An accredited member of African Network Clinical Practitioner, an accredited member of International Academic of Physician Associate Educators, and a specialist in tropical medicine, surveillance and immunology. I'm also a certified health professional educator by the University of Zambia School of Medicine, Department of Medical Education. I'm a senior lecturer and director at Laplace School of Health Sciences. I welcome you all to this presentation. And remember, you can find more lectures under my channel of YouTube, where you can subscribe. Currently, I'm giving some brief lectures, which for those who may have interest to learn more about clinical applications in medical physiology, these may subscribe to my channel. Okay. Now, for today's session, we are going to look at the following. Before we can go, I like Sir William Osler, a good physician, to study phenomena of disease without books is to sell uncharted sea. To study books without patients is not to go to sea at all. So you cannot apply your basic sciences properly, okay, without books, where you just say, no, I will just be seeing patients, I will just be doing practicals without books. Okay, you are moving like someone without a direction. A patient comes, you are guessing, you don't understand the mechanisms. Someone is presented to you with diarrhea, you don't know the mechanisms. Or what you know is just to put up a drip, and the drip is going to save life. If a drip is not infused appropriately, it cannot save life, but it can endanger life. Again, to just study books without seeing the patients, it's just like you have never been to the hospital. And then you just go on Google and see a drip and study, go in this textbook and study without seeing patients. This will not be complete. So my lectures are contextualized to clinical practice from medical physiology. Okay? So this can be useful even for those clinical officers, even other medical practitioners who would want to revise on the mechanisms of the body fluids. They may find it so useful. So today, I'll try to look at the body fluid to apply the knowledge that you have gotten from physiology in one clinical situation. Okay? And you will try to look at what happens. So today, we will look at clinical situation number one. Okay, so we'll look at clinical situation number one. So this clinical situation number one, which is in an individual, okay, who is being given normal saline. Okay. So remember, when it comes to the drips or IV fluid, it's also very important to know that when we talk about the IV fluids, we have three. Let me try to write. Okay, we have three types of fluids, main types of fluids. And let me put up the proper color. Okay, number one, we have normotonic. Okay. We have normotonic. Number two, we have hypotonic. Number three, we have hypertonic. Okay. So, normotonic can also be called isotonic. It can also be called iso or smaller. Okay. Now, when we talk about the normotonic, we are saying that the concentration of osmose or the osmolarity is equal. Okay? When we talk about the hypo, we are saying the osmolarity is lower. And when we talk about the hypertonic, we are talking about osmolarity is higher. Now, since we are looking at a clinical application, now, when we're looking at a clinical application, then we are applying to the human body. We are applying to the patient. What happens? So today, on this clinical situation number one, we are going to look at normotonic fluid. Okay? So example of normotonic fluid, it is normal saline. Okay. Normal saline. So normal saline is very much equal to the concentration of the body. When you look at that drip, it is going to show you 0.9% of sodium chloride. Going to show you 0.9% of sodium chloride. Okay? Sodium chloride. Now, when you check on this drip critically, you are going to find sodium there. Okay? It's about 154 osmos. Chloride, it is also 154 milliequivalents or osmos. So when you add this together, it's going to give you, this is 8, this is 0, and this is 3, 308, okay? Milliosmos per liter. Now, when you look at this osmolarity is about 270 to 300. That's the normal range of osmolarity. Now, in the clinical practice, okay, we only experience a change when from the maximum, there's an addition of 20 milliosmos. So we are saying 300 to less than 320. There's no clinical significance in terms of change, in terms of concentration. That's the reason why the normal saline, which is having 154 there, chloride and sodium 154, does not make a fluid shift inside there. Okay. Now, let's try to now see what is happening. So from here, let me put up a pointer. What we're able to see is that we have osmolarity here, and then we have volume. So when we look at this diagram, the osmolarity is telling us how many osmoles are there. What is the concentration of the osmoles? Then when we come to the volume, it is telling, showing us how much volume, the amount of the fluid that is there. Okay. Now, we have two major compartments. We have the compartment which is intracellular. The word intra means inside. So the fluid that is inside the cell. And then we have the fluid that is outside the cell. So this fluid that is outside the cell, it is called extracellular fluid. Now, someone may be asking, but we are talking about extracellular fluid. How come they can see, in fact, this should be this interstitial fluid plus plasma, okay? So from here, coming up to here, this forms the extracellular fluid. All this fluid, it is outside the cell. So we call it extracellular fluid. Now, we have the fluid that is moving in the blood vessel, which is called plasma. And we have the fluid that is stagnant, which is in the interstitial fluid. This is where the issues of edema comes in. Okay. Now, let us try to look at what is happening in this clinical situation, number one, where this patient has been infused with normal saline. So we look at normal saline here, and then he's infused, let's say maybe 1 liter is infused there, okay? And what we can see there is a giving set, and then what we can see there, it is a what? It is a blood vessel, and then what we can see there as the arrow, we can say it is a cannula. Okay, then you know a human cell does not have a cell wall. So what it has, it is called a cell membrane. And this cell membrane, it is also called the plasma membrane. And usually we call this plasma membrane to be a bilayer phospholipids plasma membrane. Remember that we have it's a two-layer, and in between the membrane, I think you can remember Mr. Mijero very well on this aspect in terms of the cell, where he talks about chemistry. So for chemical reactions to occur, you know, we have talked about the cholesterol. It is in between this plasma membrane. Okay. So you can revise, go through, and go and check, go and do a review on the plasma membrane physiology. Okay, so that you can have a very good review and revision to get to understand what I'm trying to explain here. But now, what we need to know is that after now here, in what separates the plasma and the interstitial fluid is also a capillary wall. So there's a difference of the capillary wall and the biplasma. The bilayer phospholipids plasma membrane, meaning that what is the core guy here in the extracellular fluid, it is sodium, and here it is potassium. So these are the ones that are trying to maintain osmolarity here, okay? So it means that sodium here goes out, potassium here is supposed to be in, okay? And the other part, I'll come and tell you what I call what-induced hyperkalemia. Okay? When you go in the hospital, you'll be surprised. You find some people, they are busy rubbing, some even patting the arm at you ama veins na abelama. Ero bambo kula umapo. Te futakwa wafidia. Yo medicine ni taya wako. Okay. So, that is very unscientific. Yeah? That is traditional kind of practice. Unrational. But in this era of the 21st century, I expect you to apply the 21st century of medicine. Okay. So, te kula umapa luela au. Mule umati otuma veins. Ile mrefu kupanga na clinical chemistry. Kumi mwana fikati mwadisharira imwe. You are too down for practice of clinical medicine, rather medicine or clinical chemistry. Okay? So ni physiology tapava, yali bashalo. Right? So I expect you to apply the proper physiology here. So I'm trying to explain that in this extracellular fluid, okay, sodium is able to penetrate from this area up to this area, but it cannot come here, okay? Because I've said when you go and do a review on cell plasma membrane physiology, you discover that there are seven channels here, okay, that are able to control the movement of the what? The electrolytes. Okay, now listen what's happening here. Remember, whenever we are putting a needle in the patient, we don't go in the cell. There's no evidence, there's no scientific explanation where a needle can go into a cell. It's a cell that will go into a hole of a needle. That's why when you do full blood count, you measure the cells. Okay, listen now carefully. When this cannula is inserted, this cannula is not inserted in the interstitial fluid compartment. No, it is inserted into the blood vessel, which is plasma, a vesicular compartment. Okay, now, when is this fluid is coming into the plasma, meaning that the fluid is able also to penetrate the capillary wall and come to the border of the plasma membrane. Now, it will not penetrate to intracellular fluid. Why? Because the concentration of normal saline, as we have checked here, has the same concentration of both intracellular and extracellular. Okay. Now, I like giving a practical example here. When you buy Fanta drink, yeah, right, which is a carbonated drink. So when you get Fanta and you buy maybe a crate of 24 bottles of Fanta, and then you pour all the 24 bottles of Fanta into a bucket or a jar, okay, what will be, will the sweetness of Fanta increase because you have increased the number of bottles? Hope I expect your answer is no. No matter how many bottles you are going to put together, to add together, to combine, the sweetness of Fanta will just be the same with one who is just having one bottle, and it will be the same with one who is having 24 bottles. The concentration of sweetness will be the same. But the question is, what will be the change? The change will be the volume of Fanta. So the volume of Fanta is going to increase, but the sweetness will remain the same. That's the concept that we have to understand when we're talking about normal saline. Okay. Now, you can see that on my diagram here, which is Loeb's diagram, it's explaining on where you can see a red compartment here. So when you see a red compartment here, meaning that the normal, before infusing normal saline, this compartment was from here and ending up to here, where you can see the blue. Now, why is this red compartment and this arrow showing expansion towards the right side? And this is what I have written to be expanded fluid. Now, I want to start explaining on what's happening here. I also like asking this question in the clinical world. What do we call this change? Okay, the change where there is no, only there's no expansion of the intracellular, only extracellular fluid is expanding. We call this change iso or smaller volume expansion, or we can call it normotonic volume expansion, or we can call it isotonic volume expansion. What it simply means, when we look at the iso or smaller volume expansion, we are just coming to this Loeb's diagram. So the Loeb's diagram is showing osmolarity. That's where we are looking at iso smaller. It is, we are trying to talk about the concentration of the osmoles. Okay. And then volume expansion, Loeb's diagram shows you that the volume has expanded towards the right, meaning that this is what is happening. So what is happening on this diagram, that there is no increase in solute concentration or osmos or osmolarity, but there is only increase in the amount of the fluid, meaning that is fluid expansion or volume expansion. Okay, now let us look at what's happening in this patient. In this situation, the patient is infused, okay? Let's try to take some key important words. This patient is infused with normal saline. Okay. So this patient is infused with what? Normal saline. Now, what are the changes? It is very important to know that they are 8 important changes. 8 clinically significant changes when we infuse normal saline in the patient. Number one, the extracellular fluid osmolarity is constant. Why is it constant? Because the concentration of osmolarity in the drip and the blood fluid in the human body, they have the same osmolarity. So there will be no need of or solute concentration. Number two, there is extracellular fluid volume expansion. Why? Because this fluid, liter that you are trying to administer, they are unable to come to intracellular. So what it means that when they are coming here, they'll be bouncing back and go facing this side. Hence, as they go this side, they are increasing. So what will happen is that when you are putting 20 bottles of carbonated drinks of same concentration like Fanta, when you keep on putting in a bucket can be full to the level of spilling even to the ground, but the sweetness of Fanta will still remain the same. That's the reason why we have extracellular volume expansion. Number three, there's no fluid shift. Oh yes, there's no fluid shift. How? Okay, because the fluid has the same concentration, hence all these areas have same concentration. Hence, there will be no way of moving of fluids from a lower concentration to a higher concentration. So there will be no that fluid shift because of same osmolarity. Number four, intracellular fluid osmolarity is constant. Exactly. This also inside the cell, it will remain the same because there's no fluid that is going there. There are no solutes that are entering the cell. So the osmolarity will be the same because the fluid has same osmos concentration. Okay. Now, blood pressure increases. Why blood pressure increases? Okay, this is very important. Where we hear no miladia sana soti, gamlela soti mwewa kwata BP, you know it increases the blood pressure. You know when a patient has got blood pressure, do not need to infuse normal saline. This is what it means. Now, let us try to discuss something here. Okay, I'll write on top there. BP, okay? BP, blood pressure, is a product of cardiac output and peripheral vascular resistance. Okay. Now, this cardiac output depends on extracellular volume. You should take that note. Okay. Cardiac output depends on extracellular volume. So the higher the extracellular volume, the higher the cardiac output it becomes. The lower the extracellular volume, the lower the cardiac output it becomes. Now, you've seen also that the blood pressure is depending on what? Cardiac output as well as peripheral vascular resistance. So when the cardiac output is reduced and peripheral remains the same, the BP is going to still reduce. When the peripheral vascular resistance is the same and you increase cardiac output, then it means the blood pressure is going to increase. So in this situation, what have we done? In this situation, what we have done is that we have increased extracellular volume. It has expanded from here. Now it has expanded to this level. Then it means we have increased extracellular fluid compartment. Then the cardiac output has increased, resulting into increase of blood pressure. Okay. So this is the reason why. So even when we are putting salt, eating a lot of salt, too much salt, what will happen is that when you put too much salt, you are increasing the extracellular fluid concentration, which is going to trigger the cells to start losing water, and it will go out to extracellular volume. Meaning that in that case, the cells will decrease in size, and then the extracellular fluid is going to expand. Still, it's going to increase the blood pressure, and that's the reason we don't encourage salt or sodium chloride to wear to patients who are hypertensive. Neither do we encourage to put normal saline. Of course, in other series, as we are going to advance into clinical sciences, I'll still come and tell you under renal physiology. Okay, hope you are following. Now, remember, we were talking about blood pressure increases, and we have explained the mechanisms that is involved in the increase of blood pressure. Okay. Now, the size of the red blood cell is constant. Good. Correct. This is very important. Hope now someone here, even before I explain, someone can explain why the red blood cell is constant, the size. Why is it the same? Okay. A very good clinician quickly will come to this diagram. Okay, and we'll look at this diagram. Since there is no fluid shift, since there is no intracellular volume expansion, the reason why the size of red blood cell is constant is because there is no intracellular fluid expansion, because osmolarity is the same, so nothing is coming inside the cell to increase the size. Okay. That's the reason we are still having the extracellular fluid expansion. We come to another very important here. Okay? Very, very important. Hematocrit, and then we also talk about another important, which is the HB. Okay. Now, when we say hematocrit reduces and HB reduces correctly, okay, what we are trying to say here is that hematocrit and HB are the same. Now, hematocrit is a packed, is a volume that is packed by the red blood cells. Okay? The volume that's packed by the red blood cells, that's what we call hematocrit, and we also call it packed cell volume. And hemoglobin, it is a fraction, it is a one-third of hematocrit. Okay? So when hematocrit increases, even hemoglobin concentration is going to increase. When hematocrit decreases, even hemoglobin is going to decrease. Now, let us try to explain the mechanism behind here. So I'm going to draw two test tubes. Okay. Two test tubes there. Okay. And now we are going to put in blood, fluid there, we put it fluid. Okay, I'll use red to talk about the red blood cells. So the red blood cells, normally, they are here. Okay. Let me try to use this one so that I can become so quickly. Okay. So the red blood cells, they have occupied all this. Okay. The red blood cells have occupied. And now, after red blood cells they have occupied, the blood settles, and then we have a yellow fluid, which is called plasma. So in the normal one, we have there, okay. So let's assume that at normal there, this is at K. So at 45 there. And then what we do is that here we are going to have, let me use blue color. So here we are saying the volume that is occupied here, it is 45. And then from there, the volume that's occupied there, let's say 75. Okay. So now, we want to demonstrate that is test tube A. Now, let's look at test tube B. Okay. So test tube B, we still are going to say the volume is still 45. We're not going to change. The concentration of the red blood cells, it is still at 45. Okay? It's still at 45 there. Okay? And then let us put the plasma now. So plasma increases from 75, I'll change the color a bit. This is the ordinary, okay? At 75 there. Okay? And then there's an increment to 100. After adding normal saline. So I've used the green just to show us the increase. Okay, 200 after adding normal saline. So what we're able to see from there is that it is still 45 here, and then it is at 75 there. And then it is at 100. So now let us calculate to prove what our hematocrit is. So from A there, it is 45 over 75 times 100, because hematocrit is in percentage form. So 25 there is 3. 25 there is 4. So 4 times Z, then we can have 3 there, 1, 3 there, 15. So 15 times 4, that is 60. So here we have found that hematocrit is 60%. And if hematocrit is 60%, what is Hb? So Hb there, since Hb, it is 1/3, okay? Hb is 1/3 of hematocrit. Then 3 there, 1, 3 there, 2. And then we have 20. So meaning that the hemoglobin there, it is 20 grams per deciliter. Okay, that is from test tube A. Now, what of the test tube B? Okay, which is test tube B? So test tube B, we are going to say 45 over 100 because the volume now has increased from 75 to 100 times 100. So what we do there, 100 there, 100 there, 1. What do we remain with? It's 45. So this is 45%, which is hematocrit. What of Hb? Hb, we are saying it's 1/3 of hematocrit. So 1/3 of 45. 3 there, 1. 3 there, 15. So Hb here, it is giving us 15 grams per deciliter. Okay, 15 grams per deciliter. So now, when we look at this Hb, and then you look at this Hb, is it the same? No. In A, Hb is telling us it is what? 20 grams. Hematocrit is 60%. After putting the normal saline, it is showing us what? It is showing us Hb to be 15 grams per deciliter and hematocrit to be 45. That shows this point what it means. Hematocrit reduces, Hb reduces. Okay, and now this is what we call in physiology to be hemodilution. But this is the mechanism. So it means that when you put a patient on normal saline and you do the lab results, you do full blood count. So when you do full blood count, the Hb is going to be low in concentration, but the mean cell volume is going to be normal and the number of red blood cells is going to be normal. And as a clinician, when you're looking on full blood count, don't just rush to say anemia, anemia. Moreover, anemia is not a diagnosis. People say anemia is a diagnosis. They are not clinically contextualized. Okay. Now, what will be diluted will be the plasma proteins. Okay. This is what it means. Hope this lecture presentation has helped you to understand the concept on clinical situation number one, where we administer normal saline into the patient, and we have seen the age changes that has occurred, and we have tried to explain the mechanisms that are there or the changes that comes when normal saline is administered. Hope this lecture has been useful for you, and if it has, please remember to subscribe. Thank you very much. Viva ML. And the next one, we will look at the clinical situation 2, which we'll look at next time. Thank you very much. Or maybe we can still continue. Okay. We can come on clinical situation 2. What is happening? Here's a scenario. In a patient with complaints of diarrhea, vomiting, urinating isotonic urine, or having hemorrhage? What is happening in terms of the body fluids? What is happening? Okay. In a situation it presents to you at the hospital, having diarrhea, vomiting, urinating isotonic urine, or hemorrhage. So when you look at the diagrams here, you find that osmolarity is showing us the concentration of the osmos and the volume. Now, in clinical situation number one, we are having an addition of normotonic fluid. In clinical situation two, we are losing normotonic fluid. So it's very important for you to know that diarrhea, it is normotonic fluid loss. Vomiting, it is normotonic fluid loss. And then urinating isotonic urine is also normotonic fluid loss. Hemorrhage or bleeding, that is normotonic fluid loss. I can still give the same example of Fanta. What happens if you are enjoying and then you spill the bottle? Fanta bottle was full and then you spill half. Will the sweetness decrease of Fanta? Hope your answer is no. The sweetness of Fanta will still remain the same, but the volume is going to decrease. That is what we are talking about. So what do we call this change? This change is called normotonic or isotonic or isosmolar volume contraction. That's why you can see on Loop's diagram showing in the arrow of contraction, reduction in the fluid, okay? But the intracellular fluid remains the same. The volume of intracellular fluid remains the same. So what's happening in this patient? Let us move together now. Okay, physiology is very sweet. So let us move together in this patient. What's happening in this patient? Okay. Number one, what's happening in this patient? Extracellular fluid volume contraction is there. As you can see, what is it reducing there? It's not a concentration. Osmolarity still remains the same, but what is happening here, it is the volume reduction. Okay, so there is volume reduction. This is what's happening. And then no change in extracellular fluid osmolarity. Yes, because what is being lost is the osmotic fluid. So we cannot normotonic fluid or isosmolar fluid because it has the same concentration. So still there's no fluid shift between intracellular and extracellular fluid. That should be always be remembered. Okay, there will be no fluid shift between these two compartments. Okay, there will be no fluid what? Shift. So as long as there's no fluid shift, meaning that the intracellular fluid will still remain the same. Blood pressure reduces. I think you are still remembering from what we have discussed. We are saying cardiac output depends on extracellular what? Fluid. So the higher the extracellular fluid, okay, the higher the BP it becomes, meaning the higher the cardiac output it becomes, the higher the BP it becomes. So BP is dependent on cardiac output, and cardiac output is dependent on extracellular fluid. That is what is happening. That's the reason why blood pressure is reducing. Now, red blood cell remains the same. Yes, to remain the same because there is no fluid what? Shift. And plasma concentration becomes concentrated. Okay? Plasma concentration becomes, I mean, plasma proteins becomes concentrated because the volume is low, is reduced, and hematocrit and hemoglobin increases. I can still demonstrate because some students here, they get confused. Okay, so test tube A, what is happening? Test tube A, we are going to, in fact, we're going to draw three here. Okay, we're going to draw three here. Okay, or maybe I can use this. Let me try to rub so that to rub here. So that we draw a nice one, a third one. Okay. So let me draw a nice one here, which I'm going to use as C. So A is normal. Everything is normal. So I'm going to say hematocrit there. Let me put red. Hematocrit there is still at 45. Okay. Then I'll use yellow to show plasma. Okay. So when we talk about that, also I'll use also same concentration, which is 45. Okay, it's still 45. And then the plasma concentration in this patient has reduced. Okay, so when it has reduced, so I'll show in this way. Okay, then I'll draw another one showing same plasma concentration at 45. Okay, same plasma concentration at 45. So I'm using red as an hypothetical diagram. And then I'll use plasma to have yellow. Okay. So now, this is what I'm going to. In fact, I think since we are looking at this patient, I think let me rub the other diagram here. Okay. So that I concentrate on two diagrams, which you can see from there. Now, we have diagram A. Let me write diagram A. So the diagram A, and then we have diagram B. So now what's happening that in the scenario number one, as you can see, scenario number one, okay? Scenario number one, this patient, we were infusing normal saline. Okay, and when we are infusing normal saline, what now we experience was the volume expansion. Okay, and now in clinical situation number two, this patient is either having diarrhea. Remember, I've said that whenever a patient is having diarrhea, what are we having is that we are having normotonic fluid loss. Even in vomiting, we are having normotonic fluid loss. Even urinating isotonic urine, we are still having normotonic fluid loss. Even hemorrhage, we are still having normotonic fluid loss. So what is the difference between clinical situation number one? clinical situation number one, this patient were infusing normal saline. And I said normal saline in Zambia or in clinical practice, it is 0.9 of sodium chloride. And I said that sodium concentration of osmos or milli equivalents, it is 154, and chloride it is 154. Now, when you add 154 plus 154, what you are going to get, it is 308 milliosmos per liter. Now, why does this make a clinical significance? I said that the normal range of osmolarity, it is 270 to 300. Now, you have to add 20 milliosmos per liter, because I said that we do not see in clinical practice any clinical significant change in terms of osmolarity, even if we are to administer normal saline in this patient. Okay, now let's concentrate carefully here on this clinical situation, which is now different. Here, a patient is not being given normotonic fluid. In this situation, the patient is losing normotonic fluid. Now, diarrhea, vomiting, and urinating isotonic urine or hemorrhage or bleeding. Okay. Example of bleeding may be in clinical practice. Okay. We can have important clinical area issues. We can have antepartum hemorrhage. We can have postpartum hemorrhage. We can have RTA, road traffic accident. We can have hemorrhage there. So in these clinical situations, what we are having there is what? What we are having is normotonic fluid loss. So here it is at 45. And then here, before bleeding, it was at 75. Now, after the patient bleeds from here, okay, where it is 75, it now bleeds up to 60. Okay, so let us find hematocrit in test tube A. So hematocrit in test tube A is 45 over 75 times 100, because it is a packed cell volume, so we measure in percentage. It's going to give us 25 there is 3, 25 there is 4, 3 there is 1, 3 there is 15. Okay? So 15 times 4, we have 60%. Now, since hemoglobin, it is one third of hematocrit, then it means it is one third of 60. 3 there is 1, 3 there is 20. So what we are having there now, HB, is 20 grams per deciliter. 20 grams per what? Per deciliter. Okay. So, 20 grams per deciliter, this is what we have found in test tube A. So, this was before the patient developed diarrhea or vomiting. So, now, take note here. The hematocrit or the packed cell volume, we have calculated to be 60%. And then hemoglobin, since it is one third of hematocrit, then we have found 20 grams per deciliter. We want just to address this concept where we are saying hematocrit or hemoglobin increases. Okay, so let us see the truth. If it's true, it does. So let us calculate hematocrit in test tube B. So we still have here, it is 45. You remember, because there's no change. So 45 over 60 times 100. Okay. Then 20 there, 3. 20 there is 5. 3 there, it is 1. 3 there, it is 15. Okay. So 15 times 5. Okay. 5 times 5 there, what you get is 25. And you write 5. 5 times 1 there is 5 plus 2. What you get there is 75. So you've seen that hematocrit here, you have found to be 75%. And since, how do we look at HB? Remember, HB is one third of hematocrit. So one third of hematocrit, that is, we have found is to be 75. Now, 3 there is 1. 3 into 7 there is 2. And carry 1 there, 3 into 15 is 5. So what do we see there? HB is now 25 grams per deciliter. Okay? Now, what are you able to see here? We're trying just to answer scientifically, because in physiology, we don't need to be dreaming whenever mechanisms are happening. Okay. So this is what it means. So what it means that if you were to look at the full blood count result, in particular of the red blood cell indices. Okay. When you look at HB, it's going to show you polycythemia, because when we say polycythemia, we're talking about the hemoglobin concentration or hemoglobin to be higher. So already here it is giving us 25 grams per deciliter. That's polycythemia already. Okay. But before you come to that, you have to look at the MCV. So the mean cell volume here, what will happen to the cell? The mean cell volume will be normal, will be still normal. The number of red blood cells concentration will be still normal. So when you look at those indices, please do not need to look at HB and start worrying, no, the HB is too high. When you look at MCV, it's normal. And for a clever clinician who look at the clinical features that have been presented, or some physiological changes, which we can see there, there's diarrhea, vomiting, or maybe the CPH, maybe you're in labor ward. Okay, there's antepartum hemorrhage. This is bleeding before delivery, and postpartum hemorrhage, that's bleeding after delivery. And there are two types of postpartum. Okay, we have primary postpartum and secondary postpartum. So the bleeding between delivery to 6 hours or to 24 hours, there's also bleeding up to 6 weeks. That is secondary, right? So, or there is the patient is brought in a situation where is a victim of RTA, and you are at the emergency bay. Now, you have to be quickly look at this scenario, because if you're not carefully, you may say it's polycythemia, and you start even troubling yourself to talk about polycythemia vera and physiological one. So this is a scenario that is happening. Hope everyone here has gotten the concept. Okay, so this is what happens. Now, this corresponds to also why the blood pressure is what? Is low. Because the blood pressure, we have said, is a dependent on cardiac output. And cardiac output is dependent on extracellular volume. Hope clinical situation number 2 is understood and you've gotten the concept, and you'll be able to apply this knowledge whenever we are going to practice in the clinical area. Here we have got clinical situation number three, something different. Okay? In this situation, you're able to see that the normal diagram from beginning, it was up to here. Okay? Now, two things involved here. There is an increase of osmolarity. At the same time, there is a decrease of the volume. Okay? Let's see what happened. What could be this kind of situation? Let's look at Loeb's diagram explanation. Let's put up a pointer there. In this situation, your patient eats a lot of salty potato chips, or eats salt fried groundnuts, or is infused by hypertonic fluid like mannitol, you know? Okay, whenever we have some parties, birthdays, white coat ceremonies, caping ceremony, and let's say the students are having caping ceremony, or white coat ceremony, or birthdays or graduation ceremony, and they are eating a lot of salt potato, no salt sweet, mean potato chips, and they are putting a lot of salt from there. Okay, what will be the changes that will happen? Or this patient is eating groundnuts fried with a lot of salt on it, or this patient is infused with hypertonic fluid like mannitol. What will happen? Okay, so let's look at what changes would you expect in this patient. Remember the basics we did on both fluid compartment lecture. I think that one you did with your physiology lecturers on the both fluid compartment physiology. Okay, now, clinical officers, students, what do we call this change? Of course, this change, it is called hypertonic or hyperosmolar volume expansion. So what happens in here? Extracellular volume is higher. Okay? Why is it high? Why is it high? There is a change of osmos concentration because they are putting what? Salts. So you are increasing sodium here. Sodium chloride. Okay? There are two salts. Okay? There are two salts. Oh, it's hypertonic. So meaning that the concentration, okay? What will happen if you are taking water, okay? And then you had made a cold drink, you had put 60 spoons of sugar into a 150 ml of glass of water, and then you tend to add, okay? You tend to add maybe even more sugar there. What will happen? There will be more concentration. Okay? Now, in this scenario is that when this part becomes concentrated, okay? When this part becomes concentrated, then it is going to trigger the fluid shift. So meaning that the fluid shift now will start moving from intracellular, okay, to start moving from intracellular to extracellular fluid. So it will be penetrating. I call this kind of physiology boy-girl kind of scenario. So I'll give an example. You can see students at your Plascovial Sciences or at another college, you discover that when there are females there, you're going to see a lot of visitors who are male because those are concentrating that area. And it is triggering of movement of boys following the girls. This is the scenario that is happening on this clinical situation number three. Right. extracellular volume expansion. Okay? Yes, correct. And then what happens to intracellular fluid osmolarity? What will happen? Okay? So what will happen from there is that what will happen to this osmolarity, as you can see on the diagram. First, when it will move to this way, as this one to do equilibrium, then osmolarity has to increase. Okay. Then the intracellular volume is going to reduce. This is what we have seen here. It has reduced from here, okay, from here to here. So now it has remained from this area. Let me put up the right colors there that you can see properly. Initially, the volume was from this side. Now it has reduced up to here. So what is remaining here is this now area. So meaning that this area has been lost. That's what we mean by that. Then the blood pressure increases. Yes, because we are saying this blood pressure depends on cardiac output, and cardiac output depends on extracellular fluid, not intracellular fluid. So since BP depends on cardiac output, then it means the BP will still be high. Now, what happens? Hematocrit and HB reduces. Okay? Why? At this scenario, the reduction is drastically much, because there will be two mechanisms. It's going to reduce because of extracellular fluid expansion that has occurred due to fluid shift, which is there. Then there will be also reduction of cells. The red blood cells are going to shrink. Why? Because this cell has lost the fluid. So meaning you have seen that the compartment there, it has reduced from this area up to this area. So there's shrinkage. So there's double reduction of HB. Okay? The plasma concentration are reducing because of extracellular fluid what? Concentration. This is the clinical scenario 3. Let's try to go in clinical scenario 4. Here now, a patient has got adrenal insufficiency or Addison disease. Okay, so what is happening here is that, as you can see, that there's a normal diagram there, okay? This is ordinary. Before the situation happened, it was okay. And then what has happened there is that there is reduction of osmolarity there, okay? And then there is the increase of volume in intracellular volume, and there is decrease of volume in extracellular volume. Okay, so what is happening here? Let me put up my annotate there, or my pointer. Changes that, first of all, what do we call this change? It's called hyposmolar, hypotonic volume contraction. Okay. So when you look at this, what's happening is that there is a dilution of concentration in the extracellular fluid, meaning the intracellular becomes more concentrated, and it triggers now the movement of fluid from lower concentration to the higher concentration. So meaning that this intracellular has become more concentrated, so there is fluid shift there from extracellular fluid to intracellular fluid. And in this scenario, you are going to get a picture that the intracellular fluid is becoming big because it is not losing, it is gaining. From clinical situation 3, the cell is losing because the extracellular fluid became concentrated. And then in this clinical situation 4, it went to patients with adrenal insufficiency or Addison's disease. What is happening there is that the patient is having a fluid shift where the intracellular now is the one that is becoming concentrated because this one has become hypoconcentrated. So what are the changes? Extracellular fluid osmolarity reduces due to loss of sodium chloride from extracellular fluid. So now, what is happening if sodium chloride has been lost? Then we are talking about aldosterone hormone being impaired. Remember when we talk about the loop of Henle? When we talk about the loop of Henle, we have two principles. We have antidiuretic hormone and as well as the aldosterone hormone. So antidiuretic hormone is against the fluid loss. So it is against diuresis. That's why we call it antidiuretic hormone. Now, the problem in an adrenal insufficiency, there is a deficiency of aldosterone hormone, which is able to take back the solutes of sodium. Okay? So meaning that there's no control of sodium chloride. The gate that controls sodium chloride, it is weakened or it cannot perform or it is not active. Simply means that this patient is losing more solutes, not the fluids. Okay. Now, this is what is happening. So now it's triggering the fluid shift from extracellular to intracellular because when this patient is urinating, let me try to do an hypothetical diagram, but I think when you start doing the physiology too, you understand, or medicine, you're going to understand the renal physiology properly. So this is the loop of Henle. Okay. And then there we have a droplet of urine. Good. So now, here we have two principles. Cells. Okay? So we have this one here. This is an antidiuretic hormone. And then we also have aldosterone hormone. So this is cardinal to understand on what is happening here. So now, this one, ADH. Regulates the water flow. Then this one, we have aldosterone hormone, which will look at the salts regulation. So when there is in conditions of Addison's disease or adrenal insufficiency, the problem is that the steroid hormone is impaired. So it cannot send back sodium. So there will be drastic loss of sodium chloride, meaning the solutes are lost here. So what will happen? Antidiuretic is performing very well, so it is able to retain water back. Now, there is more loss of solutes and less loss of fluids. Hence, this fluid is now diluting the solutes that are there. Then it means that this compartment of intracellular becomes more concentrated. Then it will trigger now the shift of fluids. So intracellular osmolarity reduces. Okay? Why is it going to reduce? As it will first increasing, as it will be increasing, I mean, why is it reducing? Sorry, it's because of this kind of hypoosmolar fluid that is coming here. It is diluting the osmolality concentration. Then the extracellular volume mean the intracellular volume increases. Why is it increasing? Because this cell is becoming taller by receiving a lot of fluids. Hence, it is increasing in size. And if this continues, it may even bulge and rupture. And then extracellular fluid volume reduces. This is what's happening. Since there's more movement of fluids from extracellular fluid compartment to intracellular fluid compartment, meaning there will be reduction. And at the end, this has to attain equilibrium, to balance. This is why you are seeing a diagram reducing. Okay. Plasma membrane concentration. What happens in plasma membrane concentration? It's going to increase. Okay. Then HB, hematocrit, is going to increase. Why is it going to increase? Because of the Z contraction. Okay. There's the hypotonic contraction. That fluid is being lost, is moving from one compartment to the other, meaning that is contraction, it is reducing. Okay. At the same time, there is hyposmolarity, meaning there's the reduction of osmolar. Then the red blood cell is going to increase. Why is it going to increase? Because it is receiving fluids, which is hypotonic or hyposolar fluid, from extracellular fluid to intracellular fluid. Let's try to look at this clinical situation. 5. In this situation, the patient drinks a lot of tap water. You drink a lot of tap water or mineral water, or is infused with hypotonic fluid, or has this syndrome of inappropriate of antidiuretic hormone secretion, which is also common in bronchogenic carcinoma. You know, when we talk about bronchogenic carcinoma, it is also contributing to impairment of the function of antidiuretic hormone. Okay, now, what is happening? This change is called hypotonic volume expansion. And this is what I'm trying to explain. Why is hematocrit and HB constant? That's another task that we have to discuss. So when you drink a lot of tap water, what is tap water? Tap water is hypotonic fluid. It's different from here, where the hypotonicity is developed because of dilution, okay? Because of loss of solutes. But in this situation, the patient drinks a lot of water because I has read in a book to say you have to be drinking 2.5 liters of water. Ah, people need to understand. You guys who are performing this program, try to educate people so that they know. Does it mean that you have to be taking 2.5 liters of water? Or what does it mean? Okay, all right, let's see what happens. Osmolarity of extracellular volume reduces. When you keep on diluting, okay, let's say you get some Fanta, and this Fanta, you start adding diluted Fanta. So when this Fanta, which is okay, you keep on adding diluted Fanta, especially in boarding houses, okay? Some individuals are clever. When you buy juice, what they will do, they will drink, and when they say, arasa yeshi womwine, they will just add water. And when they see that, drink ya unaiva sana diluted, kusa mkulomba, woy, isa tusanka nye, tuike mune yove. After diluting, the sweetness is going to go down. That is the osmolarity. Okay, quite all right. Let's see what happens. Extracellular volume increases. Okay, what is happening here for extra volume to increase? What is happening? Simply means that the first thing, when you put water there, you take water, which is hypotonic water, you are diluting the osmos, meaning this is becoming less concentrated in terms of osmos, and to be more concentrated of water. So what will happen? There will be, it will trigger shifting. So it will bring now the extracellular shift to ICF because it will follow the concentration. So when it goes to the it follows the concentration from there, what will happen? This has to come to equilibrium. Okay. Then here we are saying intracellular fluid osmolarity reduces. Why is it reducing? Because of hypotonic fluid that is now crossing the membrane and it is diluting. The BP increases. Exactly. It's going to increase because why is it going to increase? It's going to increase because of the same principle of volume expansion. Now, plasma proteins concentration reduces. Yes, because of that expansion. Now, why is hematocrit and HB remains the same in this scenario? Why does it remain the same? I can do a bit of demonstration, others are confused. So I will say test tube one. Okay, and test tube two. So let's see. Okay. The plasma membrane, let me write, use the same color. Mean the red, the packed cell volume here. Same packed cell volume here. Now, what will happen is that this, remember when there is dilution, okay? When there's dilution, we expected HB to do what? To increase. Now, since there's no dilution, I mean, there is dilution, but HB is remaining the same. What's happening is that when you look at here, the cell size is increasing. Okay? So the red blood cell is going to increase in size corresponding to the same ratio of the expansion of the fluid. So as the fluid expands, even the cell size is going to increase. So meaning that it will be the same. When this goes up, even the fluid goes up, the cell size also becomes bigger. So it will be corresponding to the same ratio of fluid loss. Hence, the hematocrit is going to remain the same. Okay. Clinical situation. A lousy girl is sweating heavily in the lousy plane without drinking water. Or the patient is having high-grade fever for 6 hours. Or has diabetes insipidus. Or there is no antidiuretic hormone. Or antidiuretic hormone function has lost sensitivity. So in such clinical situation again, what is happening here? The normal, it was like this. Okay? This was the normal. But what's happening? It has osmolality has increased. That's what we can take note there. Osmolality has increased. Then there's reduction of fluid in the extracellular. There's also a reduction of the fluid in the intracellular. That's what we're able to see. So now, let's try to see what happens. Now, there are 9 principles, 9 changes that have to be noted here. And this type of change, we call it hypertonic volume contraction or hyper or smaller volume contraction. So number one, loses extracellular, loss of extracellular fluid, volume compartment or fluid in the extracellular fluid in the extracellular fluid compartment are lost. Then extracellular fluid volume, it reduces as we can see there. Okay? Why is it reducing? There is the principle here that the patient is losing a lot of fluid, but retaining the solutes, hence becoming hypertonic. We said from there that here the problem is that the problem, andretic hormone, okay? Andretic hormone is okay. Okay? Or it is too much. Because in bronchogenic carcinoma, it precepts to production of andretic hormone. So they will be inappropriate. So the andretic hormone are too much. So when they are too much, they are too restricted for a fluid to be lost. Okay? Now, here, the andretic hormone is not performing. Or there's no andretic hormone at all. Or the function has lost. So what's happening is that there is a loss of fluid, but the aldosterone hormone is working well and is able to retain the solute, hence becoming hypertonic. So now, extracellular fluid osmolarity is going to increase because of the much loss of fluid, and there is more solute that's been retained by the aldosterone hormone. Then there will be intracellular fluid shift to extracellular. Why? Because this extracellular has become more concentrated, so the intracellular fluid is going to visit the what? The extracellular. Then the intracellular fluid volume is going to reduce. Why is this going to reduce? It's because the fluid is moving from the cell to the outside, the cell, which is called extracellular fluid compartment. Then the intracellular fluid osmolarity is going to increase. After the fluid is also leaving the intracellular, then it will remain concentrated. Then after it remains concentrated, then again fluid will go back to the intracellular until it meets the equilibrium. And this is the equilibrium that has been attained. And then the blood pressure is going to reduce. Why is the blood pressure reducing? It's because there's contraction in the fluid. Remember, the blood pressure is dependent on the cardiac output. And the cardiac output is dependent on the extracellular volume. Then the plasma proteins concentration, they are going to increase. Now, hematocrit and HB remains the same. Who can explain again here? Okay. Hematocrit and HB remains the same. So what is happening here is that, let me try to demonstrate. The first thing is the intracellular, okay? Red blood cell size. The red blood cell size is going to what? To reduce. Because first thing, there is the movement of the fluid from this compartment to this compartment. Hence, the red blood cell reducing in size. So meaning that even here, there's volume contraction. So we expected HB to what? To increase. Okay, so we expected HB to do what? To increase. Now, meaning that the increase, okay, the increase of HB is same corresponding to the reduction of the red blood cells. So the more you increase there, also here it reduces. So meaning that the ratio of reduction and the ratio of increase, it is the same. Hence, there will be no change. That's the reason why the hematocrit is going to be constant. So when you do full blood count here, what you are going to see is that the MCV reduces. The MCV reduces, but the number of red blood cells is the same, and the hematocrit is also the same. There are no changes. It is normal. Then you have to know that this is the hyper or smaller volume contraction. So hope this lecture has been of use to you and you have enjoyed. Please, you can remember to subscribe and give me the feedback. Thank you very much. You can get more lectures on my channel. Enjoy this evening. Thank you very much.